Recorded Books presents Aeon Rising by Matthew Mather. This book was read for you by Ray Porter, a member of SAG-AFTRA. The gods will come to us in forms we recognize. Dina Metzger. Neutrino. A subatomic particle that rarely reacts with normal matter. A supernova is predominantly a neutrino phenomenon. Prologue. IceCube Neutrino Experiment, Amundsen Station, South Pole, Antarctica. January 3rd, 11:52 a.m., New Zealand time.
That can't be right.
Dr. Xin Rou rechecked the data logs.
Dag, could you reboot the AI?
Thousands of detectors embedded in the cubic kilometers of ice beneath their feet had just lit up, which was impossible. Even on lucky days, only a few detectors would sparkle to signal the passage of a ghostly particle. The IT team had just upgraded the system with a new monitoring app. Xin bet it was something to do with that. Had to be a software glitch. The Norwegian IT manager's clear blue eyes, earnest grin, and stubbled chin appeared from under a desk. He was a tall, well-muscled man who looked like he'd been asked to win 3 rounds in a boxing match. On hands and knees, he inspected the network cables.
I'm on it. Could be the wiring. Might have been the Bolo who set this up.
She stole a glance at Dag's backside as he bent over. When he shifted positions, she pretended to be staring out the window to inspect the fronds of hoarfrost growing on an antenna outside. It was minus 32 Celsius out there, about average for midsummer. The sun hovered low in a cobalt sky over the bright Antarctic ice. The closest of the other scientific structures near the Ice Cube facility was the dome of the new South Pole Telescope. Beside the BICEP extragalactic cosmic radiation detector, both about 100 meters away toward the ice runway. A C-130 Hercules was in the process of landing on its skis. The lumbering aircraft bounced off the ice in a puff of feathery snow. Resupply missions came in daily from America's McMurdo station on the coast, 1,500 kilometers away over the Trans-Antarctic Mountains. Another 4,000 passed the emptiness of the Southern Ocean to reach New Zealand. This place was as isolated as you could get without traveling to Mars, and about the same temperature.
Anything yet?
Xin asked Dag. The man was out from under the tables and in front of a monitor.
Still gumbled as far as I can reckon.
She guessed that meant no. Xin checked her phone. Just before noon, New Zealand time. 4 hours back meant 8 a.m. at home. No fiber optic lines connected Amundsen Station to the world. The only comms in and out were via satellites, which were only in range a few hours a day. One was now. She dialed her mother's number. Before the first ring finished, her son's face appeared on her screen, his face beaming with a wide, gap-toothed grin.
My tooth came out,
Bing Wen said in Guangdong speech. Xin laughed.
Did you bury it?
She replied in English.
And, bed.
He replied haltingly, switching languages.
And I hope I have a mouse. The tooth of a mouse, Xin corrected. You hope you have the tooth of a mouse.
A month since she left. Felt like a year. She wouldn't be able to hold her six-year-old until he was halfway into his seventh turn around the sun. Xin and her husband had separated 2 years before. Not divorced. Not yet. And she'd had to leave Bing Wen with her parents. She couldn't stand being so far away from her little dragon. But sacrifices had to be made. Seeing his face tore at her. The image on the screen rolled around to Xin's mother. They traded greetings in plain speech before switching back to English. Xin insisted on it. The future might be Chinese, but English in scientific exchange wasn't going away anytime soon. Languages were a window into the wider world, and she wanted Bing's to be as big as possible.
How is father?
Xin glanced at Dag, who shrugged again. Still no idea what was wrong with the system. She flicked on the under-ice amplified light cameras. Sometimes one might witness a flash of Sharenkov radiation.
"He is well,"
her mother replied, which meant he was not. A glittering on Shin's screen caught her attention. Her mouth dropped open.
"Mom, I'll call you back."
She hung up without waiting for a reply. Maybe there was a software glitch, but the scintillating glitter from the photomultipliers? Normally, the under-ice cameras displayed nothing but soothing black. Now, it looked like an ocean of phosphorescent creatures had slipped beneath the ice. She punched a number on the wireline telephone on the desk. A woman's voice answered on speakerphone. Xin said,
"I need to speak to Major Rankin right away. The Major is in a meeting. Right now,"
Xin interrupted, her voice rising.
"Get him right now. This is an emergency."
Dots of light danced across her monitor. It was beautiful. Almost. Goosebumps raised on her exposed forearms. Xin typed in the web coordinates for the other neutrino observatories. Were they seeing what she was?
"What is it?"
Dag asked. Tears streamed from Shin's eyes. Her son was 8,000 kilometers away from her. And the world was about to end. Day 1. Chapter 1. Amazon Rainforest, Tres Fronteras Territory, Brazil. January 5th, 2:02 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So alien, but so familiar. That's how it felt. The roar of the Black Hawk's rotors, stone-faced men and women gripping weapons, smell of sweat and engine oil and cordite and that metal in the back of the throat burn and stomach churn as humans and machines lurched into the unknown through the dead of night. Max Carver leaned out the helicopter's open door and scanned the semi-darkness. The jungle canopy skimmed so close he felt like he could reach out and swing down into the glimmering wet leaves. Dimly illuminated thunderheads shouldered the rising foothills of the Andes below the sliver of a crescent moon. What was he doing here? Max had asked himself the question a dozen times on the commercial leg in from D.C. to Bogota, then again on the private charter prop over the mountains and the final hop in an unmarked Colombian military transport to a dirt airfield. He pulled out his picture of Talisha and held it close in the roaring wind and low light so he could inspect her slender arms cupping that beautifully swollen belly. A red light blinked on in the open cabin between the 8 jump seats bolted to the floor. 10 minutes, came the voice of the team leader, an angular-faced man named Armad Kruger that Max had been introduced to the night before. All he'd been told was that their jungle survival expert was an Afrikaner mercenary who had fought in the Congo. That, and he worked for Stillwater, the military contractor that put this last-minute mission together. The South African had to be 6'4", and the only person in the chopper taller than Max. Kruger said through the headset,
"We're doing a soft egress. Everyone spread out to cover in the edges of LZ Alpha and rendezvous at the first checkpoint. The second team will be 300 yards west of the LZ Beta. Use your GPS if you get separated. That's what it's for. Everyone body up. Night gear on. 9 till touchdown. We're covering with drones. We may contact everyone. Stand down and let Mr. Carver do the talking."
A stocky young guy seated in front of Max pointed at the photo of Tal. "That's your girl?"
"Yeah,"
Max smiled.
"Pregnant?" 7 months.
"And you're heading out?"
"In and out. Rescue mission. Just the ones that want to come,"
Max replied.
"Should be back day after tomorrow. A week at most."
"If you say so," the man's raised eyebrows conveyed, but he said,
"These are my 2 reasons for being."
The man held his rifle to his chest and fished a photo from his breast pocket.
"Asher and Ezra, 2 and 5.
He held out the family picture and angled it for Max to get a look.
"Beautiful,"
Max replied to be polite. Why was this guy talking to him? That wasn't normal in his day. This was a short mission. Focus was key. Any chatter should be related to whatever increased the odds of staying alive, and swapping kid picks didn't qualify. The man asked, "How many others you got?" Max shook his head. The man put the picture away. "They call me Bullpup. I like the format, better maneuverability." He held up his assault rifle like a birthday present. It had a short barrel, a magazine behind the trigger, and a tiny shoulder stock. RM-277 with Wolverine cartridges will get us out of any jam. He settled the rifle onto his knees. Bull for short, because I'm kind of built like one. I heard Colonel Buchanan contacted you personally for this, invited you to a White House dinner. I didn't even get a meal coupon at Outback. He was my staff sergeant back in Afghanistan. Where are you from?
Louisiana.
Nebraska City. Cornhusker. They said you were military, but not no more?
Truck driver.
Pardon me?
Rust Belt, big rigs, Midwest to New England mostly.
Truckers don't carry weapons?
Not this one.
Max hadn't touched a gun in years. That whole side of his life he had tucked away, tried to forget. Now he was married and had a child coming. Would he be a good father? Or was he running? He told himself he wasn't, but he bet his own dad had convinced himself of that. This time he couldn't drift through it. It wasn't just his life anymore.
6 minutes, Kruger announced over the headset.
When Max used to ride in on these horses 24 years gone past, they had the old M60D machine guns pointing out the sides. Now, it was miniguns and drones. In white paint marker on the housing cover of the M134 7.62mm six-barrel minigun, "How blessed are those whose ways are blameless." Psalm 119, verse 1. The gunner nodded at Max when he saw him looking. He had explained the quote when they climbed in. The kid had a Raiders insignia on his uniform, the skull and Southern Cross.
"Stow your gear," Kruger told everyone over the headset.
Max looked up from the photograph of his wife. Still a novelty to call someone wife, even in his head. He said it again to himself, repeated the mantra, and then out loud,
"Secure your weapons. Safety's on. Everyone get that?"
Apart from attempts as a tech startup manager the past 2 decades, most of his dispensed advice had been how to mix a cocktail or change engine oil. Telling soldiers what to do felt like playing make-believe in a half-forgotten game.
"What if we take incoming?" asked an Italian voice.
Max scanned the faces in the dim light. It was a woman's voice over the headset. Garza, he remembered from the quick introductions. Ginevra Garza's hooded eyes stared back at Max from across the aisle. A scar on her left cheek, her body squat and compact, powerful like a coiled viper.
"This is a rescue," Max replied to her. "If we take fire, retreat and cover. The only thing we shoot at is if tigers attack us."
"Don't think they have them in the Amazon."
"You know what I mean."
"More clarity? Briefing was short, boss."
Kruger's gruff South African voice interjected.
"GG, even if we're fired on, no return unless Mr. Carver," he pointed at Max, "gives the say-so. Questions?"
His eyes glinted dark like the surface of a river at night, his black hair slicked back against tan skin. Garza held Kruger's unwavering gaze. The edges of her mouth curled down, her shoulders shrugged, but she sat back. "Whatever you say," her body language radiated. She was part of the U4, European Special Forces, contingent on the mission. Kruger had told Max she had been the only female member of Italy's 9th Parachute Assault Regiment. The lone woman in that storied anti-terrorism squad had to be twice as good as anyone else there.
"What if they don't want to be rescued?"
"Pardon?"
Max said. Bull leaned toward him.
"What if they don't want to be rescued? That's my point. It's called the colony, and that sounds like a rich person's resort to me. Have a drink with an umbrella in it. Rescue mission is all good except when the people are happy where they are. I mean, Waco. Nobody wanted to be rescued there. What a snafu that was.
You said this is a cult, right?" Kruger stood back up between the rows of jump seats. The red light flickered orange. 5 minutes. I didn't call it a cult, Max replied to Bull.
What if something happens to you?
Meaning what?
If you pancake out that door and can't give the word to fire back, then who does?
Kruger said in a gravelly voice.
Get that rifle stowed, Bull. Stop jawing.
Max hung back out over the side again, looked down as the Black Hawk plunged into a low cloud. The cool light of the crescent moon went dark. Pitch black. He clipped his night vision into place. Kruger and Garza seemed to have worked together before this. Bull, too? Maybe. But Max's combat senses were muted. He was too old for this.
Didn't they say the guy running this place is your buddy?
Bull asked.
Long time ago, Max said.
But he is your friend.
Max didn't reply.
I heard some things about this place, Bull said as he unstrapped to put his weapon away.
Weird stuff. I seen pictures, man.
Droplets of water from inside the cloud wicked against Max's face.
Burning Man on acid, Bull said. That's what I heard this place is like.
Everyone had been on acid when Max had gone a decade before. He said nothing.
Tell me straight, man, what's going on?
The truth was, Max didn't know.
We can't shoot back. That's the deal?
Bull fidgeted in his seat as he strapped back in. Max knew guys like this, ones who couldn't stop talking when it came down to it. Max didn't like to talk, even in the best of times. Not that he didn't like conversation, but he wasn't eloquent. Couldn't find the right words until a half hour later. Better to say nothing than sound stupid.
1 minute,
Kruger announced. A flash, low in the sky, spilled blood red across the horizon before blossoming into a searing white. Light so bright, its photon ice picks bit deep into Max's optic nerves, the surrounding clouds igniting like magnesium flares in tubs of ball lightning. Max cursed and squeezed his eyes shut, flipped up the night vision and pressed the balls of his hands into his eyes to ease the pain. The glowing afterimage burned bright green. Was that a nuclear blast? No sound outside the roar of the chopper rotors. He opened his eyes for an instant but had to close them immediately in lancing agony. Tried again, squinting hard. His vision swam through watering eyes. Incandescent tendrils appeared draped across the sky, pulsing orbs between them like schools of neon jellyfish scattered through the heavens. Blue skies. The sun shone bright, low on the horizon, brilliant like a diamond on fire, but tiny, compressed into a pinpoint. The chopper burst through a billowy blue-white fog bank. The green canopy of the rainforest wheeled below, swearing from the pilots over the headset between calm exchanges of checklists, the ratcheting whine of the rotors as the chopper angled. Max clenched his jaw, held tight as the bird whipped around. Black of night a second before, but now clear daylight, as if transported through a wormhole and into a blinding future of snow-capped mountains in a cyan sky of anvil-topped thunderheads. Warning alarms wailed in the headset. Engines strained as the Black Hawk spun. Bull was out of his seat, grappling for help. With his right hand, Max took hold of the guy's hand as he slipped out the open door, then grunted with effort as Bull's full weight ripped at his arm socket and jerked him sideways. The horizon tipped at a stomach-lurching angle as the chopper went into free fall before high-loading G-forces slammed Max back in his seat. Branches and leaves whipped through the open door, tore at his arms and face as metal screeched in a rending, juddering roar. Max strained and held tight, one hand clasped with Bull's, the other still gripping his picture of Talisha. Chapter 2. Le Croissant Café, Burlingame, California, 1:22 p.m. Pacific Time. Talisha Carver sipped her latte and watched the TV in the corner of the café.
The last time a supernova was visible to the naked eye was in 1987,
said a thin woman with short, cropped gray hair, whose on-screen title identified her as Dr. Rita Owen, director of the National Science Foundation.
I remember it clearly, as I was doing my undergrad in astronomy at USC at the time. There have been quite a few visible to the unaided eye throughout recorded history.
How many, exactly? Asked the news anchor, a young, square-faced man in a dark suit and red tie in the bottom right box on the TV screen.
In the last 2,000 years, this is the 9th one we know of.
So these are regular occurrences?
Like clockwork. Several ignite in our galaxy every century. In the year 1054, one was even visible during daylight in blue skies for a year. The event noted in literature around the world. The remnants are now known as the Crab Nebula.
The news anchor paused to take a serious look into the camera. The big questions all our viewers want answers to. Is this dangerous? How bright is it now?
Like a crescent moon, but in a single pinpoint,
Dr. Owen replied.
As yet, we're not too worried. I want to remind your viewers that the supernova we are now calling Aeon appeared almost directly over the South Pole and is not visible from the Northern Hemisphere.
Which is all very well for all of you in the Northern Hemisphere, countered an agitated-looking man in another on-screen box, his accent Australian. Do we even know how far away this thing is? How bright it will get?
Dr. Owen paused to scratch her face.
We're still evaluating.
The dose of ionizing radiation last evening might have wiped out a lot of what remained of the ozone over the Antarctic. The man interrupted. Do you have any idea?
Tal turned her attention away from the argument ensuing between the scientists on the TV and sipped her latte again. One cup of coffee a day. That was her limit. She cupped her left hand under her belly and felt the baby kick. He always woke up when she had coffee, or ate something greasy and sweet. A few crumbs, the only remains of an almond croissant on a plate in front of her. She had a table by the open window of the cafe, a warm and pleasant day for January in Northern California, blue skies with a few puffy white clouds. Families walked by outside on the main street of Burlingame, a busy Saturday of shopping and errands and coffees with friends. Cars lined up at traffic lights in both directions. The Walgreens across the street had large signs up announcing discounts on Christmas merchandise. Just a regular day. More or less. A line of lunchtime customers stretched out the door beside Tal. All of them stared down at their phones. At the tables outside, people peered at their screens. Most of the people walking by did as well. Everyone watching videos taken when the supernova had ignited 8 hours earlier. For a minute or two, the supernova had turned pitch darkness into full daylight anywhere south of the equator. In places below the tropics that were in daylight when Aeon lit up, like Australia and New Zealand, a second sun had appeared overhead. Countless dash cam and security camera feeds from Brazil and Argentina showed a bright dot appearing in the night sky, the pinpoint flashing to overload camera sensors into whiteout for a few instants before the images stabilized into what looked like full daylight and blue skies, with the sun shining bright, low on the horizon. Except it wasn't the sun. Scientists weren't yet agreeing on which star had detonated or how far away it might be, or even what exactly had happened. The initial bright flicker of light had immediately dimmed. While scientists weren't yet agreeing, the general public had become instant experts on exploding stars. Supernovas come in two main types, said the news anchor on the TV. Type 1 are white dwarfs that burst when they become supercritical in mass, and type 2 are supermassive stars that collapse and then detonate. In each, however, the light from the supernova is preceded several hours before by a wave of neutrinos, which was how Dr. Xin Rou of Tsinghua University predicted this blast almost 3 days ago. Dr. Owen, why was this warning not heeded?
I wouldn't characterize this as a warning, Dr. Owen replied. It was an internal NSF communication from the IceCube project at the South Pole, where Dr. Rou is working. That could not be verified.
Tal took a good look at Dr. Rou on the screen. A picture of a demure young woman with long black hair in a lab coat, and then another of the same woman with what she assumed was her young son and husband. As the discoverer of Aeon, Dr. Rou had now become perhaps the most famous person on the planet. The news channels were going nuts trying to get interviews with Dr. Rou, but all channels of communications to the South Pole were jammed. A short burst of ionizing radiation had also knocked out a lot of satellite communications and tripped off power grids, temporarily, in the south. Two airliners had almost crashed. Tal did a search on her phone, then scanned a news story. The snooze on snooze, read a headline on The Guardian, featuring another picture of Dr. Rou with a copy of her Twitter post from 3 days before. The supernova early warning system monitored 7 neutrino detectors, and only one of them, the IceCube project, had detected the surge. The whole program was run by the NSF. And Dr. Rita Owen was the director of the NSF. Tal looked back up at her. It was a little disorienting to watch someone on TV who she had recently met in person. Dr. Owen had been at the White House Christmas party 3 weeks before when Colonel Oleander Buchanan had asked her husband Max to go on a mission in Brazil. What was the head of the NSF doing at that party? It had to be a coincidence. But the worming uneasiness in Tal's gut wouldn't go away. She held a hand down again as she felt the baby move. They lost communications with Max's mission right when the supernova went off. Tal had been asleep in her room at the Crown Plaza Hotel across the street when it happened, but in the Northern Hemisphere it had been something of a non-event, a brief flash on the other side of the planet. Tal had flown in on the United flight direct from D.C. to San Francisco the day before, arrived at 8:30 p.m., then had gone straight to her hotel to sleep. When she woke at 6 a.m. and went down to the gym for a walk on the treadmill, the supernova was all over the news on the TVs. She had immediately called Colonel Buchanan, who informed her there was a loss of comms with the mission, but there was nothing to worry about. But she hadn't been able to get in touch with the colonel since, despite a dozen messages. Sometimes, no news was good news. Often, not, in her experience. She shouldn't have encouraged Max to go. He had said he didn't think it was a good idea to leave her at this stage of pregnancy, but she could see in his eyes how much he wanted it. She had told him she had been in the army longer than he had. She could take care of herself for a week. And it wasn't blind encouragement. Tal had been working for the NSA, the National Security Agency, for the past 3 years. She had gone and dug out the internal reports on the colony in Brazil after Colonel Buchanan had appeared and made the offer. The government didn't view the colony as dangerous, more as a technology incubator led by an eccentric frontman, Max's friend, Ben Belloc. But Tal had her own reasons for wanting Max to leave for a few days, an ulterior motive that she didn't want to tell him about. He wouldn't have let her fly at 30 weeks of pregnancy, not all the way across the country. She hadn't lied to her husband, but she hadn't told him the truth either. The guilt of her deception turned the worm of uneasiness in her stomach ever tighter. Tal picked up her phone and dialed Colonel Buchanan's number once again. Chapter 3. White House Situation Room, Washington, D.C., 2:45 p.m. Eastern Time. Lieutenant Colonel Buchanan stood in the back corner of the 40-by-20 situation room, a cherry-wood conference table occupying the middle. The newly commissioned space was fully electronically SCIF-isolated and still had that new room scent and freshly polished glint. Dome lights glowed along the ceiling's centerline with banks of white LEDs over 14 chairs, each with a nameplate in front of them. None of them Colonel Buchanan.
"Everyone, let's get to it," said President Charles. He glanced at his watch. "We are now at 0 hour plus 12 and 43 minutes. He had swept into the room while Colonel Buchanan had his back turned. It wasn't like the colonel to keep his back to any center of power. He turned and grinned his highest wattage smile, but the commander-in-chief didn't even acknowledge him as he sat at the head of the table. The man's dark skin was a shade paler than usual, his eyes calm but red-rimmed. The president collected himself and said, "Dr. Owen, if you could lead the meeting," he indicated the woman seated to his left. The head of the NSF stood, 5'3" and gaunt. She had on a dark suit over a baby blue crewneck sweater. Skin so fair it was almost translucent. The 8 screens occupying the wall behind the president lit up with an image of a glowing spot in a field of stars. "How bright is this thing now?" the president asked.
"Like a very full moon."
"I thought it was only as bright as a crescent. I saw your broadcast this morning."
"That was 6 hours ago. It's getting brighter."
"Is it dangerous?"
"Not yet, but we're not sure how it might evolve. We don't yet know the extent of the damage to the austral ozone layer, and there are many other unknowns."
"You said on national TV there was nothing to worry about."
"Those were the instructions from your office, sir,"
Dr. Owen said quietly.
"Not to induce panic before we knew what we were dealing with."
The president took a sideways glance at his communications director before saying, "I just received a request from your office to ground all domestic and international flights. Can you be more specific?"
"Sir, typical supernovas take weeks to reach maximum intensity, then fade over months or years. But this,"
Dr. Owen cleared her throat,
"is an atypical event."
"Are you worried we'll see more of these bright flashes? I need a simple answer."
"Sir, so far, there isn't one. We are updating guidance as we get more information. On the screens behind you are the latest images of the astrophysical anomaly. These views come from the European Union's CHEOPS satellite operating in sun-synchronous orbit about 800 kilometers.
"Can't we get images from Hubble, James Webb, one of our own?"
asked a gruff voice from the middle of the table, a man Oleander recognized as the chair of the Senate Committee on Armed Services.
"Hubble's circuitry was damaged in the initial burst. Same for Webb. There are 7 other optical wavelength orbital observatories we have access to, including this one, and a handful of gamma and X-ray satellites, but all were damaged in the flash. Most have been offline since."
"Please," interrupted the president, "let's keep this moving." Dr. Owen nodded and said,
"CHEOPS is a small satellite designed for measuring the size of exoplanets, not optimal for these purposes. Our best guess is the anomaly is tens of light years away. This from data based on the size of the luminous disk, which we are having difficulty imaging due to its intensity and position. In the next hours, we should get more precise estimates as new observations can triangulate. The wavefront is distorting our measurements."
"Wavefront?" asked the president.
"Eject a mass expanding around the anomaly."
"You call it an anomaly," the president said. "This isn't a supernova?"
"A stellar detonation, certainly, but it's behaving unusually, as I said."
"What about our early warning system, which the NSF operates?" Dr. Owen nodded.
"Detectors at the South Pole initially detected a huge surge of neutrinos, and given the intensity, we had anticipated seeing light from the blast within a few hours. But after a full day had elapsed, and based on the improbably large reading at the IceCube facility, most scientists were looking for another explanation. Other detectors in the network were inconclusive or offline."
"The snooze on snooze. That was the headline I got with my morning coffee. Why am I getting my information from The Guardian and not my own team?"
"Sir, the 2 detectors at the Gran Sasso lab in Switzerland were under renovation. The Canadian project unfinished, and the Super K in Japan was in the process of upgrading with gadolinium. The Chinese reported that Daya Bay was offline. With only 1 report of such an abnormally large reading, we were looking for other explanations. But 65 hours after the reported neutrino surge, we had a 2.3 solar flux event."
"English, please."
"The anomaly
lit up to more than twice the brightness of the sun for a few minutes before dimming. It's what's called a breakout flash, before the main sequence of a supernova's light curve. That flash included a burst of gamma and X-rays that irradiated the southern hemisphere last night and interrupted power grids, much like a thermonuclear electromagnetic pulse called an EMP.
Are we going to see more of these?
We don't think so, but the point is that supernovas can ignite in ways we never thought possible. That's why we need the data from the South Pole observatories that were pointed up at this thing when it went off.
Which Dr. Xin Rou, a Chinese national, is collecting.
Dr. Rou had impeccable credentials, sir. We have people on the ground monitoring the situation at Amundsen Station.
And what's the data telling us? First impressions.
Sir, it's on its way.
A man whose nameplate identified him as the chief of staff of the Air Force held up a paper from the middle of the table. Drives from observatories at the South Pole were copied. Can we wire it over? Satellites?
Petabytes of information, sir, would take months to transmit even if we could, and the DSCS geostationary serving the South Pole is offline.
Physical transport is the only option. The first full package of data is arriving now at McMurdo Station on the coast of Antarctica. A few hours after that, it will be en route to Christchurch in New Zealand on a C-17 Globemaster. We'll get it on a high-speed interceptor from there. Tomorrow night, we should have it here.
Tomorrow night?
The president absorbed this before asking. Based on the information we do have, what's the most likely explanation for this thing?
Dr. Owen replied, Sir, a white dwarf. They are dim, cooled down leftovers of stars as massive as our sun, yet sometimes smaller than our moon. They can ignite into supernovas somewhat unpredictably, and they're everywhere around us. At local interstellar distances, one might have been invisible to our sky surveys. There are at least 300 within 100 light years of Earth, and dozens within the 10 parsec kill zone.
Kill zone? Asked the president.
Distance to Earth, which triggers an extinction-level event. On average, one supernova detonates within Earth's kill zone every 100 million years. The Hangenberg event, the second-largest mass extinction event 300 million years ago, is an example. Rapid changes of sea levels, global exposure to high amounts of radiation, the destruction of animal and plant life, ozone depletion, anoxic conditions.
Anoxic? The president asked.
Lack of oxygen in the atmosphere.
My God, the president muttered under his breath. Dr. Owen continued.
A more minor event 2 million years ago caused the extinction of the megalodon sharks, among other species, but most terrestrial life survived.
Most? This kill zone is how many light years?
About 30.
And we are within this zone?
We don't know yet.
Silence in the room for two beats. The president laid his hands flat on the table. You're telling me there are giant invisible bombs floating in space around us and we have no way to know where they are. And one might have just ignited in Earth's kill zone. Is this the consensus? Silence again in the room, but this time tentative nods from most of the scientists. The president asked, How did we not know about this months in advance?
We had no warning, sir,
Dr. Owen replied. Nobody at NASA, NOAA, none of the intelligence branches, none of our three-letter agencies? The president scanned the room of downturned faces. What about Dr. Rou, the Chinese scientist? She practically handed this to you on a plate tied up with ribbons 3 days ago, yet I'm only getting wind after it hits the fan. Colonel Buchanan watched the exchanges as the scientists tried to blame each other. He'd been as shocked as anyone else when the supernova flashed into existence, and this was the first time he'd heard about a kill zone. But what was more important to him was whether Max Carver was still alive. Chapter 4. Amazon Rainforest near Japura, Brazil. 2:52 p.m. Eastern Time. Max Carver groaned and pulled at the strap holding him into his jump seat. He was pinned in place, something jammed against his left side, up to his knees in dark water that flooded the cabin of the wrecked chopper. The light was low, not black, not night, but not exactly day either. Raindrops spattered onto the metal skin of the Black Hawk's ruptured shell, ran in streaming rivulets down the ripped door frame beside him. Over the tapping rain, the humid air was heavy with an uproar that seemed to grow louder and louder. Sounds saturated the rainforest around him. Even the trees seemed to pulsate with it as the din ricocheted off the high canopy and cascaded back to the ground on a tidal wave of buzzing and shrieking and clicking. A clear, flute-like birdsong rang out between the chirping of unseen frogs pounding out a collective beat from the forest floor. The taste of copper in his mouth. He spat out a mouthful of blood, leaned his neck forward. 30 feet to his right, the unclear outline of a shape blotted an outgrowth of ferns. He focused. The body was half submerged, the face turned away from him, but those arms. That was the young guy he'd been talking to, Bull. Max swiveled his head to the left as far as he could. The woman, Garza, was slumped forward in her seat, the seat beside her empty. He couldn't look any further left to see what was pinned against him.
"Hey,"
he managed to wheeze, and then louder.
"Hey, anybody? Hello?"
The thrumming soundscape of the rainforest drowned out his calls. He yelled, his chest spasming with the effort, but he didn't hear any reply above the clamor of the insects. He heaved in a steamy lung full of air, the heat and humidity already suffocating. Max closed his left eye and opened it, then his right. He still had both eyes. Good. His left arm was trapped in place. He checked his right. The hand almost numb, but he could wriggle his fingertips. Made a fist. Lifted it with an effort to check his face. Felt his teeth. Still there. Nose where it should be. Strained to look down and did a quick check of his midsection. No gaping wounds he could see or feel. And he could still move his legs. Lancing pain erupted in his right side as he struggled to raise his arm high enough to get a grip on the metal buckle of the jump seat straps. Gritting his teeth, he pushed through the agony and unclipped one side and then another. His left arm came free as he slumped forward into the water. Breathing deep, he arched his back. What the hell happened up there? His mind was still trying to reassemble the images of the bright flash and blue skies before the thundering violence of the crash. It didn't make sense. Slipping on the submerged metal floor, he got to his feet, using his left arm to steady himself against the empty seat in front of him. He leaned over, put a hand in front of Garza's nose, and felt a gentle puff of air. She was still breathing. Kruger's seat was empty. The fuselage twisted up and angled to the side. The airframe warped around the trunk of a tree he could now make out. He couldn't get to the pilots, but seeing the way the front of the chopper was bent up, he wasn't optimistic. To Max's right, a groaning over the noise of the rainforest. Bull was face down in the ferns, up to his waist in the muck. A shift in the dark behind the man. A surging wave moved in a way Max was only too familiar with. The snout of a caiman burst from the undergrowth. Max took 2 high steps through the water and threw himself into the air on top of the creature before he could speed the last 10 feet to Bull, who was still unaware. Sliding on top of the animal, he felt it twist and buck as it turned back to him. He used his legs to pin himself around it, just like they used to do when the gator wrangled back in the bayou. He wrapped both arms around its snout as it snapped its head back. But this was no Louisiana gator. It thrashed and twisted beneath him, then submerged and pulled Max under. He breathed in a lungful of muddy water and gagged. The animal surged upward and dragged him with it. He couldn't keep his arms locked around its mouth. In the dim forest undergrowth, he glimpsed something. A woman. Blonde. The caiman flipped over and turned onto Max, submerging him again. He flailed against it. It had his right arm in its jaws now and turned again, pressing him against the muddy bottom. Fingers of mud seemed to curl up around him, cradle his body somehow.
like hands pulling him upward, but it was too late. Max screamed into the water as he felt his lungs fill up. His last thought was of his wife, Talisha.
I should never have left you.
Day 2.
Chapter 5. Northern California, 10:02 p.m. Pacific Time. Talisha Carver stood and requested one more with an index finger held high over the crowd. Two other customers were also calling the waiter. The harried man raised his eyebrows as he caught Tal's signal. Their eyes locked. He shook his head. She jabbed her finger in the air again before sitting down. The lights of San Francisco twinkled over the bay. Tal had a four-seater by herself right on the waterfront terrace of the Trident restaurant in Sausalito. The day before, the mood had been calm in the streets, but today there was a nervous energy in the air. People walked by with their eyes down, shopping bags packed high in the backs of SUVs. Not everyone was worried. The bar here was packed. She wore a cardigan, but the propane heaters couldn't take away the midwinter chill coming off the Pacific waters churning under the Golden Gate. Usually nobody would be outside at this time of year, but this was the best place to witness the spectacle. Tal stared past the lights of the Bay Bridge at the purple line of the supernova's glow on the southern horizon. She felt the baby flutter and put a hand down to soothe him. Her husband had wanted children, or at least said he did, but she knew a part of him was afraid of being a dad. Max might be reluctant, but he was going to be an amazing father. She just needed to get him back here with her.
"What have you gotten yourself into, Max?"
Tal muttered under her breath. Him going off on a mission into Brazil was as much her fault as his. More her fault, really. The guilt of her deception still turned uneasily in the pit of her stomach, but then she was already here, and maybe now there was even more of a reason for her to be. The waiter hustled through the crowd. He wore jeans and a black vest over a t-shirt, the sleeves rolled up on his bulging arms like he'd just been to the gym. His black hair combed back to one side.
"Ma'am, you're going to have... Please, I know I'm taking up too much space."
The man's biceps twitched as if that were exactly what they were thinking.
"Ma'am, please, take a table inside to the front. Rules are just a little longer."
3 hours ago, she had promised the waiter that her friend was about to arrive. One beer and no food order later, and her welcome had worn out. Bicep boy put his pad into his fanny pack.
"Ma'am, I'm going to need to speak to the manager. Please?"
He relented.
"What do you want, ma'am?"
"A Coke?"
She smiled as pleasantly as she could.
"Please, just a soda this time."
The man returned her smile and turned back into the crowd toward the bar. Still, no contact with Max's mission. Some of the cable channels were predicting that commercial flights would begin again tomorrow. It was like watching the news about a novel virus emerging on the other side of the planet. Frightening, in a distant way. Something to occupy her over morning coffee as she scanned news articles or catatonically sat in front of doom-mongering cable stations. But would it really affect them up here? Aeon was shining on the opposite side of Earth from America, with the entire planet blocking and protecting the North. As normal as things still felt, some were starting to panic as Aeon steadily brightened. Internet stories circulated showing empty toilet paper and flour shelves at grocery stores. Half the country was heading for the hills, while the other half said they were overreacting. A glass of dark soda dropped onto the table in front of her.
"This drink is on us,"
the waiter said.
"Sorry about earlier."
"No, no, I'll pay, please,"
Tal replied.
"Cash okay?"
No credit cards, no trace. Bicep boy was working for tips. A full table, dinner for four would be, what, $40 in tip? She handed him $3.20s. He held up his palms.
"On us, ma'am."
She proffered the bills.
"Take it as a tip.
Come on, I've worked tables too."
"Please."
"Sorry again for giving you a hard time. Stay as long as you want, ma'am. Appreciate the tip."
He gave her a genuine smile this time and took off to the next table. Carrot and stick. Always use a carrot and stick. That was a lesson her father, who grew up on the rough streets of L.A., had taught her. Although he had been better at the stick part, which was why her mother had left him when Tal was 10 years old, picked up and left America and gone back to Israel and her family there. Her mother had taught Tal that it was always better to leave people happy if you could. You never know when you might meet them again, or need them again. She took a sip of the ice-cold Coke and returned to staring past the twinkling lights of San Francisco at the thin purple haze of Aeon. It looked harmless from here. Quiet. Serene. But was it her imagination, or had Aeon's glow become brighter? Its color shifted. The glow wobbled and shimmered. A presence loomed next to her. Without looking up, she said, "Love is the law." That was the agreed code. A heavy-set man, 6'2", in a velvet black hoodie lined in red, slumped into the chair in front of her, his back to Aeon. His face was covered, and in the outdoor lighting from above, only his full lips and wide chin and scarred cheeks were visible, eyes dark beneath the hood. His forearms dropped onto the table, one to each side. Large, soft hands, but with powerful fingers that looked like they could dig into rock. The breeze brought a pungent mixture of what smelled like cinnamon and cloves. Tal leaned back and away from him. The man asked in a low voice, "Can you do what you need to do here?" Accent flat, but definitely American.
"It's risky," Tal replied, "but I can do it."
Flying home tomorrow wasn't an option anymore. He reached across the table and deposited a memory key in front of her.
"Install what's in here behind the NSA firewalls from inside the Security and Operations Center. You understand, you need to run the exploit from inside the SOC.
Tal cocked her head to see behind him. The glow of Aeon was definitely brighter. The murmuring conversation from the crowd rose an octave in pitch. People around them pointed at the horizon. The man said,
"We need to expose them before the AIs control us."
This was the first time she had met in person this contact who went by Monk.
"Algorithms are the new gods,"
Monk continued.
"We've become their byproducts. They control our food, logistics, even the way we think. They knew about Aeon before it happened."
The way he spoke gave Tal the unmoored sensation of falling down a conspiracy rabbit hole, but then again, what had she expected? This was transactional. She wasn't trying to make friends. She needed his black market network exploits, a zero-day hack nobody else had access to. She held a hand to her stomach as the baby moved.
"I'll install it as soon as I can," Tal said.
"You shouldn't drink,"
Monk said.
"You should mind your own business."
"This is my business. You're pregnant. You never told me that."
"That is absolutely none of your business, but yes, this isn't easy for me."
"Isn't easy."
Monk pulled back his hoodie. His head shaved, maybe early 30s, flat nose. Even in the dim light, his face an ethereal white. He was albino but African-American, and those eyes. Heavy, jutting brows over orbs that seemed to shine red from the inside. His corneas pink and scarlet ringed. This was a mistake, Tal realized. In her mind's eye, she felt herself starting to flail on a plunge down a cliff. Monk said,
"Ain't easy is my life. You use this phone to keep in touch from now on. They knew about this."
He motioned at Aeon behind him.
"And didn't warn us. Things have changed."
One meaty hand dropped a cell phone on the table next to Tal, an old model, flip phone. He said,
"They're inside everything. Use old tech anytime you can, oldest you can. You understand?"
Gasps from the crowd. A shimmering yellow tendril snaked high into the night sky behind Monk, his skin translucent milk as the glow of Aeon burst into auroras in the heavens behind him.
"Let me tell you what we need to do, Talisha,"
he said as he leaned in, his hands big as dinner plates as he raised them around her. Chapter 6. Location, undetermined. Time, undetermined. Max Carver watched poison dart frogs peep below palms leaning in through the open bedroom window, the drumming of insects in the air. A dragonfly buzzed above a rhinoceros beetle that reared to defend itself. Max slid under the covers of the bed and luxuriated in the nearness of his wife for a moment. In his romantic relationships, Max noticed that some people, when you smelled them, really drank in their natural animal muskiness. They either had the right odor and drew you closer, or didn't feel right and repelled you, and there was absolutely nothing you could do about it. Two people simply had to smell right together. It was either there or it wasn't. From the moment they met, Max and Talisha had snapped into each other like magnets, as if two people had suddenly become one. To him, Tal somehow tasted of honey when they kissed, the sweetest and most potent, her skin smooth to his touch, like the texture of a cup of hot coffee on an easy Sunday morning. Something about her with him was so right. 7 years together. Married 6 months before in a small ceremony at the county registrar after they found out they were pregnant. He couldn't fathom life without her now. Max wormed his way under the covers toward his half-asleep wife. The light was low, just his reading lamp on his side, but sliding over on his back, Max noticed the cracks in the plaster ceiling and the yellowish stain in the corner where water had leaked through. The room's narrow metal-framed door had a rust spot at the top. He propped himself up, glimpsed the threadbare carpet over parquet flooring. At the end of the room, the second-hand cot he had assembled the night before. Sliding into the middle of the bed, Max wedged his right hand under his wife while with his left he cupped her baby belly. He sensed the baby almost like it was inside him.
"What are we going to name him?"
He put his head down to her stomach.
"After your dad?"
Tal whispered back.
"Not that asshole."
"Language,"
Max said.
"Why? You think he can hear us?"
"Your dad?"
Now his wife was being silly. He liked that about her.
The baby.
"Max, honey, come on, seriously. Your dad passed years ago. You should let go. Forgive."
"And what about yours? You really want to go there?" Max exhaled. "Sorry, I'm still feeling awkward."
In a lull of conversation at the White House Christmas party a few hours before, Max had started explaining his failed business to Colonel Buchanan and the senators and members of Congress. The logistics of a small trucking outfit hadn't illuminated anyone's imagination. He hated small talk at parties. Tal said,
"It was a good idea, honey. It just didn't work out."
She adjusted herself in the bed.
"I didn't know you and Ben Belloc were so close. I forgot you ever mentioned you were friends. You don't talk about him."
"He was like a brother to me."
Tal put a hand to his head.
"You okay?"
Max's only biological brother, Charlie, had committed suicide the year before. Maybe accidentally overdosed. He hadn't left a note. Either way, another sad statistic in the nation's siege with opiates. Max pushed away an image of Charlie smiling in the sunshine when they were teenagers, before all his brother's troubles had started. At least he was at peace now. Or anyway, that was what Max kept telling himself.
"I'm fine,"
he said after a pause. Tal said softly,
"Must have dredged up memories today. That Senator Copeland woman called Ben the Preacher. Where's that come from?"
"His dad was one. Hellfire and damnation and conspiracies under one creaking steeple. As much of a piece of work as my own."
"Running away into the Amazon is a way to get away from family,"
Tal mused.
Billionaire techies building apocalyptic compounds is a cliche wrapped in its own trope.
That's not Ben. He didn't run away from things.
He was the nicest guy I've ever known,
Max said. Me and him and Charlie were inseparable when we were kids.
Until they weren't.
Max couldn't remember the reason they stopped hanging out, if there even ever was one.
Did there need to be? People drifted apart. That was his whole life before Tal. Drifting.
His mind filled with an image of a curtained room, loud static on a tube television, a buzzing vibration inside his skull, the silent crying of a name in words that made no sense. Tal ruffled his hair.
Maxie, you okay? You tuned out.
The image faded. A cult is everyone else's religion except your own. Buchanan said Ben was more of an influencer than anything else. I checked out the colony website. Ben even does TED Talks. Does that sound crazy to you?
Lots of kinds of crazy out there these days.
Tal moved herself in the bed again and groaned. Max knew she was having a tough time with the third trimester, a struggle getting her comfortable, especially to sleep. She said,
"You said you haven't talked to him in more than 20 years.
Did you know that there are as many trees in the Amazon as stars in the whole Milky Way galaxy?" Tal sat upright in bed. Max's head fell off her stomach.
"Are you really thinking of going there?"
When he didn't answer right away, she added,
"Are you being serious?"
Max propped himself up. "You heard Colonel Buchanan. His daughter is there. How would you feel if our child was in danger? Those two senators, they seemed scared too. A lot of people want their kids back."
"Those kids they're talking about are adults making their own decisions. You just said Ben was the nicest guy you ever knew."
"But who knows what's going on down there?"
"Exactly my point. You do see this big belly right here, right? A little kid who needs you, who has nobody else in the world but you?"
Max leaned back in the plastic garden chair outside the front of his house, a cold beer in his hand, unopened. So far. Fat droplets of humidity beaded up its sides. He could almost taste the hops inside, just looking at it. Sighing, he put the beer down on the brickwork patio, if the broken patchwork beneath his chair could be called a patio. Near midnight, and streetlights provided the only illumination. A tagger had recently scrawled in bright red on the front of the brick building to his right, "Who's watching the watchers?" Max stared at the spray-painted message and wished he didn't live in a neighborhood where it was normal for people to deface buildings. Police sirens wailed in the distance. The smell of someone's joint wafted by on the breeze. Weeds sprouted between the stones in the pathway out to the sidewalk, the road just hidden past a crumbling brick wall. Bars over the windows to the house, even over the screen doors. Ward 7 was that kind of neighborhood, even if it was right across the Anacostia River from downtown D.C., an 18-minute drive from the White House, but into an entirely different universe. Their place was a one-bedroom rental in a stack of row houses. He was sure it had previously been a crack house from the cleaning they had to do when they moved in, but it was only for a few months. At least that's what he had told her 2 years ago. "To save money for a real house," he had said. Tal worked for the government now, an NSA subcontractor job she started 3 years ago. She made a decent salary. But with rent and house prices these days? Max was the weaker side of the equation. He'd grabbed the stack of mail from the kitchen drawer on his way outside, opened a few envelopes, but he knew what was inside, which was why he stuffed them into a drawer, hidden away from Tal. Late payment notices, overdue credit cards. A brightly colored frog hopped through the weeds. The colonel had taken Max aside before they left the Christmas party, explained that this would be a quick trip in and out and that Max didn't need to do anything except talk to Ben, make sure that there wasn't a problem. Colonel Buchanan's company, Stillwater, was putting the mission together and it would be a collection of military and private with some European special forces, as there were Swiss and French kids in the Amazon whose parents wanted them out too.
Buchanan said they would take the place by force if Ben couldn't be convinced to stand down. Max would be paid $100,000.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.